Fighting cybercrime is big business around the world. By the end of this year, the financial impact of cybercrime is expected to surpass $10 trillion, according to the firm Cybersecurity Ventures.
One of the fastest growing economies is cybercrime. You can see where the risk versus reward is incredibly appealing to somebody who wants to steal from other people.
In today's digital world, cybercrime is a growing, and at this point, inescapable threat. Hackers are becoming more sophisticated and dangerous by the minute, jeopardizing individuals and businesses alike. By 2031, a business will fall victim to a ransomware attack every 2 seconds, according to Cybersecurity Ventures. This is a substantial increase from 11 seconds in 2021. And contrary to popular belief, this cyber pandemic isn't confined to the actions of cybercriminals alone.
"90% of the time when you hear about a cyber incident, there's a human involved in some way. So Sally's clicked the link, Bob has opened an attachment, someone found a USB in the bathroom."
But I'd go back to the MGM Resorts breach, $100 million loss event. And the pivot point in the breach, the point at which the attackers had their runaway success, was an impersonation call into a help desk where they got somebody's credentials given to them. And after that, they were off to the races.
Human error accounts for 68% of data breaches, according to the 2024 Verizon Data Breach Investigations Report, with phishing being the prime culprit.
"Untrained employees are significantly more vulnerable to cyber attacks, phishing, scams in general. Consequently, such employees can represent a weakness for the organization."
By 2025, global damage from cybercrime is expected to hit $10.5 trillion annually. According to Cybersecurity Ventures, this staggering statistic is a direct result of today's cyber threat landscape, which, with the introduction of new technologies such as the Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, and machine learning, has only grown more dire.
"We are already seeing AI make phone calls with real-time conversations. These attacks are happening daily and combining fake emails with SMS and voice to make them more convincing has become much easier and more scalable for attackers."
"Everyone has a digital footprint. If you've been breached by a credit reporting agency, if you've been breached by a bank, if you've been breached by retail, your information is on the dark web. So they learn about you. They know your mother's maiden name. They know your favorite color. They know your car. They use all of that information, not just to answer your secret questions, but they know that information. Say, hey, we went to high school together. We went to college together. That's the difference between 5-10 years ago to now."
Cybersecurity Ventures reports that global cybercrime costs are expected to grow by 15% over the next 5 years. But are these overinflated figures, or are cyber attacks really causing that much damage to the world?
I think that you find the connection between the amount of money being made and the connectedness of many firms to the internet. Before, to get ransomware installed somewhere, you really needed to try pretty hard, and often it required either physical access to a building or a network, or somebody on the inside making a mistake and putting a device into a system. I think with more and more connectivity, more and more to the internet, plus collaborative tools and the like, I think it just facilitated that. Technology really is the linchpin for society. So now everything's connected, and I think it's just more opportunity.
With increased opportunities comes heightened risk, which experts are working tirelessly to address. Raising awareness is key. To this end, the National Cybersecurity Alliance hosts Cybersecurity Awareness Month every October.
We do campaigns all year round, but the reason that one is so successful in particular is because it allows everybody to talk about security in their own way, in a way that's relevant to their community, but still be a part of something bigger. And that's why we get people from almost 100 countries, and we get billions of impressions globally every October.
2024 marks the 20th anniversary of this valuable initiative. In that time, it's clear that progress has been made, but experts don't deny that there's still a long way to go for the industry.
We have made some strides in raising awareness, but I don't think we're where we need to be when it comes to cyber literacy. It's a gap for humans, and it's a gap for people in different roles. So sometimes we put all the energy in the people in the tech team, and we forget about HR, and we forget about the tax and the finance group. So I think it's really important that you don't leave anybody behind when it comes to cyber education and cyber literacy.
our new hires probably pose the highest risk. I think part of that has to do with the fact that they're not sure on what, say, a typical branded Northwell message would look like, so they're more inclined to open up emails and perhaps click on things. And so we spend a lot of time and effort upon the initial new employee orientation to educate them about security awareness and training. We tell them right at the beginning that we will be conducting a targeted phishing exercise to test their knowledge of what we explain to them during the training. It's just not my team that's responsible for security at Northwell. It's everybody's responsibility. And we try to instill that core value in our workforce.
The attackers are constantly evolving. The techniques are evolving, but at their basis, they work on basic human psychology, that need for impulse, to click, to do, to move before someone else, or activating that sense of urgency response. And if you breathe, if you take a moment, if you are even the least bit paranoid, you can save yourself a lot of time and yourself and your organization a bunch of money and resources.
The risk of employee compromise is concerningly high at organizations worldwide. It's for this reason that companies must prioritize ongoing security awareness training, ensuring team members are cyber aware both in and out of the office.
Employees are more open to having that cybersecurity training because it impacts their personal lives. But there's also the blurring of our personal and our business lives, our personal and business devices, our personal and business data. And therefore, in some regard, it is a little bit harder because they have to make that distinction. They always have to be cyber aware. As an example, the majority of folks are getting more and more familiar with phishing, basically phishing through email. What have cyber attackers now done? You see the prevalence of phishing, basically phishing through SMS. And there is inherently cultivating or taking advantage of human behavior where we have place inherent higher trust in text versus emails. So it is harder in the sense that it keeps moving. And we can never be complacent when it comes to cybersecurity training and awareness.
Everybody has to use technology and is a digital native nowadays. So being aware of those digital risks and educating yourselves is really important to be able to identify something that looks suspicious and not right. So I think that's one of the things that we have to keep an eye on. And we have responsibility as everyday citizens just in the environments that we operate in and how we live our lives from a day-to-day perspective.
Cybersecurity Ventures predicts that the overall market for security training products and services will be worth $10 billion annually by 2027. Yet when it comes to training sessions, most employees have come to expect arduous, hours-long workshops that will leave them yawning. To overcome this, organizations must implement one critical factor: engagement.
Employees need training that's relevant to them, ideally training that reinforces and supports the security policies of the organization, and training that is relevant to each of the unique individuals based on their risk understanding, digital literacy, role, psychographic segment, and so much more.
At MasterCard, we do monthly spear phishing training. In fact, it's probably one of the most aggressive places that I've been, which makes sense, in financial payments and technology space. That message comes from the top down. That importance comes from the top down, because even the presidents of the different business units or business groups have competitions amongst themselves on what the click rate is. That level of engagement increases the awareness.
Cyber threats are continuously evolving, with hackers employing both established and cutting-edge tactics to breach digital defenses and weaken the effectiveness of human safeguards. As a result, many organizations are left wondering the same thing. Is it possible to stay ahead? The answer lies in proactive leadership. By adapting security strategies and setting a strong example, top executives can inspire their teams to follow suit.
One of the things that organizations and leaders can promote is that personal accountability. What am I doing to keep this organization safe? I was out with many leaders recently, and I asked them, do you all have multi-factor authentication turned on? And they were like, yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think my assistant turned it on for me. And I said, okay, pull your phones out. And none of them had it on.
Multi-factor authentication, or MFA, is the future of cybersecurity, but we have a long road ahead to fully implement it. Much like the early days of seatbelts and automobiles, MFA is still a relatively new concept that requires education and advocacy.
When I looked at seatbelts, it was really, really interesting because in the early days, people cut them out. First of all, the manufacturers didn't want to put them in the vehicles. Then they started putting them in the vehicles and they wanted to charge for them. And they found that customers didn't want to pay for them. Then they started putting them in the vehicles included in the price. And there were customers actually snipping, cutting the seatbelts out of the vehicles.
Seatbelts now save countless lives every day, with drivers and vehicle occupants required by law to wear them in almost every state across the U.S. And now, cyber fighters across the globe are facing the same challenge. In simple terms, multi-factor authentication is a security measure that requires users to provide more than one piece of evidence to verify their identity. With 81% of data breaches caused by weak or stolen passwords, it's safe to say that some form of passwordless authentication is absolutely critical.
You might grumble at first when there's an account that forces the use of MFA. But that grumbling is very short-lived. That consumer friction is very, very short-lived, and people wrap their head around it pretty quickly. Our research, our OBehave report that we do every year, shows that once people have used MFA, they keep using it. Very few people take the time, if they're given the choice by the account or the software, to disable it.
If you're curious about whether mandating MFA is feasible for large organizations, take a look at Salesforce. In 2022, they mandated the use of MFA on all their applications for all customers.
That's a ubiquitous tool that's used by a lot of organizations, large and small. And so for them to take that stance, I think that was a really good move. That was a right thing to do, and I would love to see more companies follow that lead.
Encouraging better password habits is something that needs to happen across the board for all organizations, regardless of their size. It is, however, an uphill battle. So, how can we start chipping away at this mountain of tired security practices? The first step is to give people the tools they need for better habits.
I think that cyber resiliency is everybody's accountability. Everybody should have something on their annual assessment saying, here's what I'm doing to make sure that we're more cyber resilient, and here's what I'm doing in my actions to make change. I say if you share the Wi-Fi, you share the network, you share the accountability to keep it safe.
When we look at the statistics, the 80-90% of breaches involving the human element, I believe that's where we have the greatest opportunity to boost our defenses. By engaging people in this exercise, increasing the level of awareness is a first step, but fundamentally more important, helping these people understand what the risk is and how important their actions are in securing the organization, the data, and our customers. I do believe that is how we can move the needle in terms of defending against cybercrime.
It may be impossible to completely eliminate human error, but it's vital that companies understand how important it is to try. With the average cost of a data breach reaching an all-time high of $4.45 million US dollars in 2023, according to IBM's Cost of a Data Breach report, it's clear that the fight against cybercrime is far from over. This production was brought to you by the following sponsors. KeepNet ensures continuous protection for all sizes of businesses against human-targeted threats. To learn more, visit keepnetlabs.com. Outthink, a revolutionary human risk management platform empowering CISOs by targeting the source of 90% of all data breaches, human behavior. For more information, visit outthink.io. And Protexa, a B2B SaaS cybersecurity platform that leverages artificial intelligence to rapidly identify, evaluate, predict, and resolve cyber issues for employees. To learn more, visit protexa.com.